Hello again from Secure Cloud Provider. What if I told you there are steps you can take to secure your secrets in cloud? With all of the attacks that we've been having on secrets lately, there are a lot of AI-related, very interesting topics that we could dive into on this. But for today, we're going to focus on a cloud service provider using AWS as the particular example in this use case, and talk about the architectural components that can be applied at the platform, application, and service levels to better protect your secrets. As we've mentioned in other videos, a well-architected system is the absolute baseline that you must have. You need to have your standards and frameworks defined well, your tool rationalization, a defined approach and corresponding processes for your periodic reviews and for any upgrades that you do, and for when and how you do what you do. Your automation should be in place, and you need to have documentation of all of the above. Now, we're not going to talk about most of this, but we are going to talk a little bit about the standards and frameworks today, specifically as relates to secrets. AWS is going to be our cloud service provider of choice for this particular example, and we're going to look at three different layers: the platform layer, application layer, and the service layer. We're not going to be able to really examine the application layer much, so I'm just going to go over a few of those principles here, and then we are going to look on screen at the platform and service components that we would need to make sure we have controls for the secrets to be secure. At the application layer, you're going to want to make sure that you have least privilege roles, that you are not hard coding your secrets into your code, that you're not storing them in your code repository, that you are vaulting them properly, that you have scheduled hygiene, meaning that you're properly rotating your secrets and you are cleaning up any unused secrets, and that you have the appropriate automation in place as well. There's more to it than this, but one thing I do want to point out at the application layer is that although the application lives within the platform and uses the service controls that you have in place as well in that environment, it also contains dependencies and integrations that are external to the cloud sometimes. Possibly you're using GitHub as your source code repository, and that's where you're pushing your code from, etc. So all of those integrations, their dependencies, and the services that the application uses, those all comprise the application layer. So you do need to make sure that you don't have secrets exposed in any of those places. All right, now we're going to go to the AWS account, and we're going to take a look at the platform layer controls first, and then at some of the service level controls. All right, so first of all, to go over to the organization policies, let me back up here just a minute. I'm in AWS organizations, as you can see, and what I did to get here is go to policies, and then here in policies, you have a number of organization policies that are really, really useful for applying organization level controls. Now, AI service opt-out policies are not going to use the usual JSON format, as you can see here, but here's where you could restrict sharing of content for AI services. Then other policies are going to be backup policies, chat application policies, declarative policies for EC2, etc. But service control policies is what we're going to look at specifically today. Here's where you could implement controls that apply to every single account in your organization, minus this master account in which they live. Here at the organization level is where you could set a condition, for example, and you could say that, let me scroll down a little farther so you can see this better. You can say that you are denying access to everything that is not, this string not like, anything that is not this particular role is not going to be given access to do either of these two things for this particular resource. So here's where you could set a restriction that disallows anything from outside your organization from accessing your secrets at a minimum. Now I'm going to show you an example of that particular condition, but let's take a note first of the organization ID, which you can see here on the left, and then we're going to switch over to a resource policy, keeping in mind that key policies, secret policies, API policies, these are all resource policies. All right, so now we're in a key policy, which is a resource policy for a key, for an encryption key, and here you can see what that particular condition would look like. Condition, string equals, and then it gives the principal org ID, which is the same one that is shown in AWS organizations. And in this particular policy, what's being stated is that nothing outside of this organization would be able to access this key. Now, this is obviously done at the resource level, but you can also do that here within AWS organizations. Here within AWS organizations, you can also do things like restrict people from creating local users and access keys. And we'll get into why that could be useful in a minute. Here's also where you could say that only certain teams and roles could have access to do particular actions. And that's actually what we looked at here as well, where you can see the condition string not like this particular ARN or AWS resource name, which is a role, that only this role is able to take these particular actions for this particular resource. There's a lot more that we can get into at the organization level, but that's just to demonstrate a few platform level controls that make the cloud a suitable place for the applications to live. Now let's go over to the service level controls. All of these different services, identity and access management, secrets, which we will also take a quick look at, and keys, KMS, key management service, these are all services, as are more than 400 other services that live in AWS today. Here within IAM, we can see user groups, users, roles, etc. Now, roles are definitely something that should always be leveraged wherever possible. With roles, you can use session tokens, which are temporary tokens, and that is the ideal way to authenticate. Local users, on the other hand, are not something that I would ever recommend, very honestly. I did create a demo user here just to be able to demonstrate what I'm going to show you about secret and access keys. But in general, I would say completely avoid the use of users, local IAM users. They are not federated and they don't use short-term tokens. Now, when we open up this demo user, here you can see that I haven't even given it any permissions and it also doesn't have any security credentials. However, what is often used with local users and what makes them risky is the access keys. It doesn't have any access keys yet. And when we go to create an access key, let's take a look at what AWS tells us. AWS says, avoid using long-term credentials like access keys to improve your security. Well, you should be listening to AWS on this. They know what they're talking about. If you click on any one of these use cases, command line interface, it's going to show you a big warning sign and it's going to recommend an alternative. The same for each of these other items as well. Local code, applications running on an AWS compute service, third-party service, application running outside of AWS, etc. Now for other, it doesn't know, of course, what you're going to select, so it doesn't have an alternative there. But please avoid the use of access keys. It is very difficult to restrict an access key to a particular user because of how they're designed. They're simply designed as a key. If you have that key, you can access the system. So they are very, very risky. Now, beyond the secret and access keys that are used by local users, which I would never recommend, we also have secrets from Secret Manager and we have APIs from API Gateway, etc., that can be used for systems as well. Each of these is a service, and I want to point out that just as the key policy is a resource policy for KMS, each secret within Secrets Manager also has a resource policy, and we're taking a look at one of those now. All right, so to scroll up so that you can see what we're doing, we are within AWS Secrets Manager. We're in the process of creating a secret, and we're going to be giving it a name, and then we're going to be giving it a resource policy. It's called resource permissions here, but this is a resource policy. Now, when we take a look at what we're doing here, what we're saying is, and of course, we would have to actually input the account ID of the account that you want to access this and its particular role name. So what we're saying here is that this particular role from outside the account is able to perform this particular action on this particular resource here. In other words, you're allowing it to get the secret value. In addition to that allow statement, you also implement a deny statement here that says you are disallowing any principal that is string not like, that is not this particular role, from performing any type of action on this resource. So that's how you can lock the resource policy down. You can do this whether it's a resource policy for a secret, or in the case of KMS, for a key policy, or in the case of an API, you also have API resource policies. In all of those resource policies at the service level, you can lock them down within the resource permissions and disallow roles that should not be accessing it from doing so. Before we move on from the topic of service level controls and more specifically resource policies, I need to point out that secrets integrate very tightly with KMS encryption. They leverage KMS encryption as part of how they remain secret. Now, as we just reviewed, secrets have a resource policy, and that resource policy should be locked down. The same is true for KMS. Earlier in this video, we went over part of the KMS resource policy here, which is called a key policy. I need to note, however, that that is only configurable for customer managed keys. For AWS managed keys, yes, AWS managed keys do have a resource policy, but that is not configurable, which means that you cannot lock this down. That's one of the main reasons that we promote customer managed keys. Not only do you retain ownership of the key material, but you're able to control the key policy, which you cannot do if you're using AWS managed keys. Beyond resource policies, there are many other things that need to be done at the resource level. And if you're leveraging automation, you can incorporate that directly into your infrastructure as code, ensuring, for example, that you have private endpoints set up, that you have least privilege roles, that your infrastructure as code incorporates the proper parameters, etc. However, we're not going to have time to go over all of the different settings today. To recap what we just went over, at the service level and at the organization level, a lot of the same controls can be applied at specific resources in the resource policy or even in the individual configurations in infrastructure as code, but you can also apply those at the organization level, as previously noted, if it's a control that should be prohibited for the entire organization that encompasses all accounts. An example would be, as noted previously, restricting the creation of secret and access keys. Another would be who can manage encryption key policies and who's able to create encryption keys, etc. Anything that can be done in a centralized manner at the organization level should be. That gives you centralized control and centralized visibility. To wrap this up, today we considered AWS as our cloud service provider of choice, and we looked at the platform layer, the application layer, and the service layer in terms of how we could protect secrets at each of those levels. At the platform layer, we looked at organizations. For the application layer, we talked a little bit about your pipeline, your coding, etc. And for the service layer, we talked about Secrets Manager the most, but we also touched on local IAM users with their secret and access keys, APIs from API Gateway, as well as encryption keys, specifically with regard to how they integrate with secrets. Now, I'd like to cover just one more thing. Here, what we have is a rudimentary depiction of services, applications, and the cloud platform. So each of these boxes, as well as this, might be thought of as an individual service. You have S3, you have API Gateway, you have Secrets Manager, etc. All of those are individual AWS services. Each of those might integrate, however, together with the database that maybe leverages a secret here, and all of these together support the application. So the application encompasses all of the services that it integrates with, as well as any external connections it might have and any other dependencies. So this might depict the entire application, but the application is contained within the platform, which this cloud represents. And at that platform level, you're also able to assign specific controls to prohibit any actions that you don't explicitly allow. So that wraps it up for today. I hope this was useful, and I will see you in the next one. Bye.